At 5:03 p.m. local time on November 9th, a strong earthquake struck a potentially highly dangerous area off of northern Honshu's eastern coast. Registering in as a magnitude 6.8, this thrust-type earthquake seemingly occurred at the plate boundary, causing small portions of a plate to snap back upwards. This generated a very small-scale and localized tsunami, but still created one nevertheless, with a tsunami advisory temporarily being issued, with peak tsunami wave heights of up to 30 centimeters or 12 inches, eventually striking but not causing any damage. Then, a mere 51 minutes later, another strong quake, this time registering in as a magnitude 6.4, struck. No one thankfully was harmed by either of these events, but they were quite scientifically interesting. And this is for two reasons. First, these two magnitude 6 quakes had an unusually strong foreshock sequence or series of earthquakes preceding a larger magnitude quake. This involved two earthquake sequences that seemingly triggered the other, with the November 2nd to 3rd sequence triggering the November 3rd to 9th sequence. Since only 5% of world earthquakes represent foreshocks, so many foreshocks in a brief time span is unusual. Second, these recent quakes occurred on a particular segment of the plate boundary that is deemed a potential risk of producing a magnitude 8 or larger megathrust earthquake in the next 30 years that, if it occurs, will likely generate a destructive tsunami. Japan has three of these segments. The northern two, when combined, are deemed to have a 30% chance of producing such a major quake in the next 30 years, while the Nankai megathrust segment to the far south is deemed to have an 80% chance of producing a major quake in the same time span. And since any time there is a larger magnitude earthquake, the chance of an even larger earthquake occurring does temporarily increase for a time, you can see why the two magnitude 6 quakes are potentially interesting. But I know what you are thinking. GeologyHub, aren't this week's earthquakes occurring absurdly close to the infamous 2011 magnitude 9.1 megathrust quake? So, how could the same area rupture again so soon if it ruptured in 2011? And that's what you'd think. However, the region that ruptured during the 2011 quake almost went completely south, and as you can see, it just barely did not rupture where this week's earthquakes occurred. However, and I cannot stress this enough, current science cannot predict earthquakes in any manner. We can only look at the historical rate of earthquakes in a broad region and using statistics say what the average rate of various magnitude earthquakes in that zone might be during a decades to centuries long time period. The only reason the risk of larger magnitude earthquakes briefly and slightly increases following a larger earthquake is due to the very insignificant chance it represents a true foreshock. But foreshocks cannot be identified at the present, they are only identified in hindsight after a major earthquake strikes following a foreshock. In other words, by far the most likely scenario will be that no devastating magnitude 8 or larger megathrust earthquake soon strikes in the vicinity of the magnitude 6.8 and 6.4 quakes, although the chance of one occurring in the next week is technically higher than a specific week where such magnitude 6 quakes did not occur. Also, to reassure people further, an even larger earthquake at the same plate boundary struck in 1989, registering in as a magnitude 6.9. And you know what didn't follow? An even larger magnitude earthquake. Don't get me wrong, if any of these three zones end up producing their megathrust quakes one day, it will be quite destructive. Just from a statistical perspective, it probably won't be this year or the next year when this happens. Regardless, in the meantime, more magnitude 4 and 5 aftershocks are likely to follow in the next week within 30 kilometers of where the two magnitude 6 quakes struck. Such quakes, in my opinion, should be too small to cause any damage, although people on or near the eastern coastline might occasionally feel some weak ground motion. As a final note, I would like to thank my new YouTube channel member, Jacqueline Chur, for supporting my work.